Hey everybody, today we are debating creation versus evolution, and we're starting right now. Very excited to have you here, everybody. Thanks for your patience as we were setting up there. And I'm excited that we're starting to get a hang of it. Like, basically, I'm so excited, I can't even pronounce my words. We're starting to, you can tell, we're kind of starting to get the groove a little bit, where we have like maybe like one major technical disaster each show instead of two or three. So very excited. Progress, baby steps. Now, I don't want to waste any time. This is going to be an epic discussion. So this is just an organic discussion, a civil discourse, you might say, on creation evolution. And I'm glad. I love that both of our speakers are willing to assert something. You know, they've got some gusto and they're ready to say, no, actually, I don't buy that. And here's why. So, really quick, just want to talk about an upcoming debate. This is going to be a blast. Very pumped. We have, as mentioned, you've seen it before, but I can't talk about it enough because it's going to be a blast. Inspiring Philosophy, Mike Jones, is going to come and debate the Tom Jump. Look at Tom. So I love both these guys. It's going to be a blast. We hope you can make it for that debate on God's existence. So that's kind of the granddaddy of debates, at least in my opinion. So it'll be a lot of fun. So next up, we want to talk about our debaters that are here today. First, want to say thanks so much. They're giving up their time. They're sharing kind of, you could say, the best fruits of what they've read. They've kind of distilled it down. They've boiled it. They've crushed it down into a nice little smoothie where you get the very best arguments that they've come across. So we appreciate them sharing. And so with that, I want to give Jared, or Patient Beard as his alias goes, a chance to share about what he's been up to at his channel, which, by the way, link down in the description, folks. You can totally check out each of these guys' channels. Jared, thanks so much for coming on. Please let us know what you've been up to, buddy.
Hey, thanks for having me. I have been up to a lot of software on my side, so I've been leaving my poor little channel neglected. But I do have several debates under my belt that are pretty much all on James's channel here. You can find them in Google. I'm pretty good at disseminating the scientific consensus. So that's where I'm coming from with most of my debates. So.
You bet. Well, we're glad you're here, man. It's going to be a blast. And Nephilim Free. I just love when we get to bring on, so we've got new people. You know, Jared's, you know, he's debated here before, but new relative to Nephilim Free. Back eons ago, when Nephilim Free was doing battle with atheists in 2008 on YouTube, people like, did you ever have, like, I'm kind of curious, Neph, if you could just quick tell us, like, who were, like, the big atheist names that you had run-ins back in 2008? Like, who you would maybe argue with? Like, did you ever have, like, Potholer? Or who was it?
Well, I don't think I've ever been in a hangout with Potholer, but we've made videos about each other. He's done rebuttal videos of my stuff, and I've done a little bit of his. And I've done rebuttal videos of a number of popular atheists on YouTube over the years.
That's rad. So really interesting. And if you want to share what you've been up to at your channel as of late, we are excited to hear that. Now, thanks for coming on.
Well, just the same thing I've been doing all this time and all these years is doing video work occasionally that puts forth the Christian worldview and making arguments against evolutionism, atheism, false mythology.
You bet. Well, it's going to be an exciting one today. And so with that, want to let everybody know, if this is your first time here, whether you be creationist, whether you believe in evolution, whether you believe in the universe sitting on the back of a turtle, whatever it is, we're glad you're here. We are looking for ideological diversity. So feel free to hit that subscribe button, join the community, share ideas. We're glad to have you here. So with that, we are just going to jump right into this civil discourse. So this is totally freestyle. Given that stereotypically, I think usually the creationist would have the burden of proof in the sense that it's usually creationism being debated, but I have limited experience. So I'm totally happy to have Nephilim Free start, and then basically just giving a few reasons for why he believes in creation. And then Patient Beard, if you want to share some reasons why you believe in evolution, and then we can kind of just let the dialogue go from there.
Okay, sounds good. My name is Evan, by the way, Patient Beard. Do you want me to call you Patient Beard? I'm fine with that, or you want me to call you by your another name?
You can call me Jared, either way.
Jared? Okay, Jared. Just call me Evan.
All right.
Let's see. I'd like to, here we go. I'll screen share briefly something with you.
Oh, that's right. One sec. I just have to prep that. I forgot to do that.
Okay.
But don't worry. If you let me know, it'll take me about 2 seconds and I'll have it set up. So.
Oh, okay.
Are you ready on your side?
Yes.
Okay. Give me 3, 2, 1, and I'm ready for you, Neff.
Okay. All right. So, let's see. Now, so is it sharing?
Not yet.
Do you see a picture?
Let me just
maybe I didn't share the right thing.
Well, we're seeing a black screen. I think what it might be is if you keep up the Zoom window, so that's up, and then you just pull the PowerPoint on top
okay.
of it. That'll work.
Okay. Let's see. I can't seem to get the Zoom to go full screen now. It doesn't want to go. Zoom is kind of not doing right. I'm not able to.
I think you might have.
I can see you full screen. I don't know about that on the YouTube, but I can see you in the Zoom meeting on full screen.
Yeah, the Zoom meeting doesn't want to go full screen anymore. Crazy. Wait a minute. I got to stop sharing, maybe? There. Okay.
Well, do you have the Zoom?
Maybe I shared the wrong thing. So,
do you have the Zoom window minimized? Because
now I think I can share it. It'll show. Now, do you see what I'm sharing?
Yes.
A white background with some words.
I can see it.
Yeah. Strangely, it's not coming through. I'm surprised by that.
Okay. Does it appear to be full screen in my video end?
Yeah, definitely. That's why I think, I'm sorry, I think this is my fault. Don't worry, I think this should work right here. Sorry about that, that's embarrassing. Okay, almost there. Totally my fault, Neff, really sorry.
Okay.
And
I don't think it's showing up for other people to see.
It is now, so they will start seeing it right now. I can see it from the viewfinder on this side for the live screen.
Okay.
They're not
okay.
It'll be.
I'm looking at the window, the watch page for the video, and there it is. Okay, now I see it. Okay, great. All right. So, evolutionists believe certain mythologies. They believe in cosmological mythology, that is the false belief that the Earth is billions of years old since it formed from debris that left over by an exploded star, which cooled over millions of years. That's a myth. They believe abiogenesis mythology, whereby they believe that organic life, that a cell can arise from the natural chemistry, will organize matter naturally organizes itself into the complexity of organic chemistry. They believe in mutation mythology. That is the false belief that mutations build organic designs and complexity. They also believe fossil mythology, which is the false belief that the fossils in the earth show clear evidence of evolutionary change from one type of living thing to another. They believe in the adaptation mythology, which is the false belief that natural selection is able to remove the accruing negative mutations that are building up in the genome of all living things and somehow punctuate life with dramatically beneficial mutations to create fit organisms that transform one type into another. They believe another mythology that is life is chemistry. That's a false belief. Plants, for example, are not living entities. According to God's word, animal life has spirit because it has breath and blood. They believe that the human mind is merely chemistry in a physical brain. Interesting to note about plants is one of the reasons we can know plants aren't actually alive, this is a secular myth to claim a plant is living, is because plants don't execute interactions between them each other to accomplish a goal. All animal life does this. Plants don't do it. It's a symptom of life. Life interacts with other life with for the purpose of meeting a goal. Plants don't do that because they don't have sentience and they're not alive. So these are some of my assertions that the secular world believes a number of mythologies, and evolution theory is predicated on these myths. Now, I don't know how much time I have to speak about these things, but I'll just provide a couple of predictions here. I hear people, evolutionists, talk all the time about prediction. Let's examine a couple. Let's examine the idea that RNA and DNA arose from chemical soup. The evolutionist believes natural chemistry is what developed RNA through the RNA world hypothesis. The creation model says RNA was specially created, not a product of chemical natural chemistry. What's the evidence say? The evidence shows that RNA nor DNA can form from natural chemistry. If you don't believe me, I'd be happy to show you some scientific evidence from the peer-reviewed journals that verifies that. Biochemistry is the origin of DNA, proteins, biological molecules, and their function. Evolutionists say natural chemistry is developed DNA in its forms. Creation model says DNA in all biology was created not from natural chemistry, but specially created in the beginning. What's the evidence? The evidence is DNA cannot form by natural chemistry, and neither can natural chemistry produce the information, linguistics, and algorithms that are all products of intelligence that are encoded upon the DNA. From genetics, we have the prediction that change in structural design occurs, anatomy and body plan. And that's why we have a tree of life, that everything is related. All living things are a product of this kind of gradual structural design change. The evolutionist claims that mutation is the mechanism for that kind of change. The creation model says organisms produce after their kind and do not change in structural design. What's the evidence say? The evidence says mutation is no mechanism for structural design change. It doesn't happen. So there is no model that fits any predictability in evolution. Creation model is supported by the evidence. The creation prediction is verified. And evolution theory is not verified. It has no predictions that are verifiable. So that's my assertion. What are your thoughts about that?
And then Neff, really quick, if you're able to minimize the... Oh, perfect. Thanks so much.
Yep, stop sharing.
Well, you brought up a lot of interesting things. You made a few interesting claims and all of that. We know that evolution is a fact, because we've been doing nothing but piling on evidence for over 200 years in several different fields of science. Tell me something. You made a claim in there. You said that plants are not life because they do not have a spirit. You said animals and other living entities have a spirit?
Right. The scriptures say that life is in the blood or the breath.
Okay. Well,
and
what,
so animal
what,
life
what
has...
evidence? What evidence could you put forth to demonstrate a spirit?
Well, the words coming out of our mouths demonstrate the existence of spirit, because languages depend on symbolism, and there's no such thing as symbolism in physics. So physics... a purely atheistic material worldview can't explain the existence of language.
Well, you're basically saying that physics doesn't understand or comprehend symbolism. Symbolism is a construct of intelligence. You are
exactly
aware of that, right?
Exactly. It takes a mind to produce, to apply meaning to matter, or to interpret meaning from matter.
Okay, so how did we determine that there was a spirit on top of that mind?
Well, the non-physical mind is spirit. It is let me put it like this. Physical actions produce physical results.
Okay, okay.
But language is not a physical thing, it's an abstract. Okay, and abstract things don't have any measurement. You can't weigh them, and then you can't put a ruler to them, and you can't say they weigh X grams, because they're non-tangible. They're not made of matter.
And so to produce an abstract concept?
To produce a non-physical fundamental entities requires a non-physical cause. See.
But aren't we physical entities?
We're both physical and non-physical entities. We're humans are dualistic. We have flesh and spirit.
Okay, and how did you determine that the spirit is a thing?
Well, I just gave you evidence of that. The symbolism of language can't be produced by the physical.
Why not?
Because it doesn't exist at all physically. Symbolism is not a physical thing.
Well, what we have is a pattern that we have a pattern in our brains, and these patterns come together to help us move around our surroundings and understand our surroundings. And on top of this, symbolism and other abstract constructs happen. They're biological patterns in our brains. This is something that we can verify with science. We can scan brains and we can see different things, and we can test all kinds of different things. What you're asserting there is that there is more than what we can scan, and I want to know how you determined that, other than just saying that, it's not good enough that our minds, that intelligence arose from a complex pattern in our minds on its own.
Okay, so as I pointed out, a pattern in your brain would be a physical thing. But okay. Then you have to apply meaning to it.
Okay.
And matter can't apply meaning to matter. That's a nonsense idea. Secondly, there is no pattern in our brains that represents...
Why can't matter apply meaning to matter?
Because it's a category error. One is non-physical, the other is physical. I think it's irrational to say that which is physical produces something that doesn't actually physically exist at all.
Okay, so if the mind is
let me finish addressing this, please. You said there's a pattern in our brains, but that's not true. There are no patterns in our brains that represent the images that we see or the sounds that we hear. And let me share with you something to demonstrate that. It's called the neural binding problem. I've shared the wrong thing. It's called the neural binding problem. And the neural binding problem tells us that... hear this. There is no part in our brain which packages our experience, our subjective experience. From the Journal of Cognitive Neurodynamics, in 2013, scientists published papers that describe the visual binding problem and the neural binding problem, and they say there is no full field area in our brain that packages our senses for a cohesive understanding of a subjective experience. So when you see a horse, there's no pattern in your brain reproduced that represents a horse. That's not true. Science has refuted that myth. There is no such thing. They state this: there is now overwhelming biological and behavior evidence that the brain contains no stable, high resolution, full field representation of a physical field, even though that is what we subjectively experience. And there is no area that could encode such detailed information. And there's other statements like that there. So this idea, this myth that patterns in our physical brain are created by the brain and they somehow represent what we see and hear is false. Okay. Neuroscience has disproved that.
Okay, so after all that, if the mind is something that exists separate from the physical, how do you explain the severe personality changes and physical reaction changes that people experience when they undergo brain damage?
Well, as I said,
brain remove.
Okay, so humans are dualistic creations. We have flesh and spirit. And we were created by God to have both. That's what we'll always be.
Part of the spirit removed?
No, I think it works like this. The best that we can say is that the brain is necessary for cognition, and the spirit is necessary for cognition. When you mess with one, you mess with the other. The brain is a computer that allows you to interact with the world around you. and the spirit is that which actually interacts with the world around you. Okay. So if you, science has shown that, you know, you can, thinking patterns and habits people have can actually physically cause the brain to change. Like somebody who's addicted to pornography, their brain will change shape because they look at pornography hours a day. And so,
but isn't that evidence that the physical can affect the physical?
Is the physical?
Isn't that evidence that the spiritual isn't necessary if you can condition your brain by repeated exposure to certain stimuli?
No, because that's not producing something non-physical. That's just rearranging that which is physical. It doesn't produce linguistics.
But all you've told me so far is that scientists don't fully understand the problem.
No, what I've told you is that we were... No.
The fact that they don't understand the problem doesn't automatically mean that the solution is to tax something extra from the supernatural realm we can't demonstrate onto it.
Well, I think we can demonstrate it. And my explanation was that physical processes produce physical results. To produce something that doesn't exist physically at all, which is what symbolism is, or in linguistics, or an algorithm. See, an algorithm is something that is constructed in your mind, but it doesn't physically exist. You can't put an algorithm in a mayonnaise jar and say, here's my algorithm. Tell me how much it weighs, by the way, and I'll write it down. It's a nonsense question.
It sounds like you're repackaging a transcendental argument for God there. Like, how am I trying to explain it? Because there are things that exist as a product of our mind, there has to therefore be something more than just our mind. Is that kind of the gist of what you're arguing?
I think it logically follows that if humans produce things that don't physically exist with their mind, then it's not something physical that's producing them. That logically follows. It doesn't logically follow that chemistry in a physical brain produces something that doesn't exist at all.
Okay, and so your evidence for physically. The fact that the mind is non-physical has to do with the fact that we can come up with abstract concepts that are also non-physical?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Okay. That just doesn't make any sense to me.
I think it makes perfect sense. And the interesting thing is that DNA is a physical medium encoded with these non-physical things, information, linguistics, and algorithms, which is empirical evidence that life was designed by an intelligence. Well, all the science journals published articles constantly about information in DNA, algorithms discovered in DNA, and linguistics properties of DNA.
Okay.
It's not a mystery.
Do you think that a computer is alive?
No, there's no ghost in the machine.
There's no ghost in the machine. Okay. If we have computers, and with those we can demonstrate a functional way.
If we're just so, forgive me for cutting in, Jared.
I'll drop that. I had somewhere that I don't think will be very fruitful.
I think someone was just asking if we're able to see how this ties to evolution.
Point of it is that because information is a physical medium encoded with information, linguistics, and algorithms, we have empirical evidence that life was in fact designed by a mind and not chemistry. And this disproves evolution
that
theory.
That still seems like a non sequitur to me. It seems like you've just connected two things just by fiat.
Well, information, algorithms, and linguistics do exist in the DNA molecule. And the origin of them is not...
And therefore it was designed.
Absolutely. Empirical evidence. Proof.
Despite the evidence that we have. So is your position then basically this variation between kinds point of view? Like... You know, are you understanding what I'm asking you?
Well, you didn't really finish asking anything yet.
I'm sorry. That's what I was asking. Is that your position is basically a variation between kinds? Like, there is no evolution. There is no common ancestor at the top of the tree. There's special creations. And then there's kind, and then there's the kinds
Absolutely. Life begets after its kind, just as the scriptures say, and there's no evidence of structural design change, no mechanism for it in genetics, no evidence that it's happened in the fossil record, no evidence of structural design change occurring in any extant species. Any of the billion species or more that walk this earth right now have fully formed features. They don't have any incremental changes going on in their anatomies. Now, if evolution were true, then there would be a mechanism for structural design change. There would be evidence in the fossils of countless examples of anatomical change occurring, and there would be countless examples in living features of anatomical change occurring, and we don't have any of those.
We have a lot of fossils. What are you talking about? We have more fossils than we know what to do with.
We have over a billion fossils that have been recovered, but none of them show clear evidence of evolutionary transition. If that were so, then why did Stephen Stanley, Niles Eldridge, Stephen Jay Gould, and Purcell Cloud, and the whole host of eminent scientists over the last 50 years all said the fossil record shows stasis for everything, not any clear evidence of transition? They've all said that.
Oh, okay. And, so, real quick, would you agree? I was trying to bring the topic to common ancestry, and we've sidetracked off onto fossils. My question: would you agree that the wolf is the common ancestor to all the modern breeds of dogs that we have around today?
Absolutely. I don't know if I would call it a wolf. No, actually, I don't. No, I wouldn't call it a wolf. I would call it a dog kind. And I believe wolves are a variety of the original dog, just like a German Shepherd or a Collie is.
Okay. So if we go up from the scientific side of things, one generation, do you believe that bears and dingoes and I think raccoons and the dog kind there, do you believe they all have a common ancestor, or do you believe that those are different kinds?
Yeah, I do believe they have a common ancestor. I believe they're all dog. What you're seeing on the screen now is a dog, believe it or not. This is a fossil dog, a pre-flood fossil dog. That's how big they got in the past before the flood of Noah changed the Earth's environment. That's okay. A fossil of a dog. It's as big as a grizzly bear, a small grizzly bear. But it's a dog. It's 100% dog. That's massive for a dog. It's a dog that weighs 800 pounds. That's how big dogs were in the past. But guess what? It's still a dog.
Okay. If we go back even further, the common ancestor, do you believe that all of the carnivores have a common ancestor?
No.
You do not.
No, I don't believe in common ancestry for all living things.
So you're saying that dogs are a created kind, and you would say that bears, hyenas, dingoes, jackals, and raccoons are also members of the dog kind? Is that correct?
It can be difficult to find the baremans, that is, the limitations. I acknowledge that it can be difficult to say for sure that certain animals are not a part of a particular kind. I think there is obvious examples where we can just look at an animal and clearly see it is a kind, like a horse, a zebra, a zonkey, a mule. These are all obviously horse.
If you can't distinguish between the different kinds, how do you know that they were actually created kinds?
Well, for two reasons. One, we don't see transitional kinds. I mean, they would exist in the millions on this earth right now if we did.
You are aware that
and the fossil record. Hold on, you're asking me to answer a question. And secondly, there's no mechanism in genetics for the changing of one kind into another. So life begats after exactly what it is, and the genetics can't change that. Oh,
okay, for one, I don't know of a scientist alive who would dispute that statement. The genetics.
You mean agree with?
You're talking about Ken Ham crocodile turning into a duck kind of crap, right? Because that's not what evolution says.
That's not what creationists believe. No creationists believe that. That's an atheist myth.
No, that's a creationist myth that they tell other creationists that atheists believe.
No,
misrepresent evolution in that manner.
It's an AC.
That's why I was asking. When you said crosses the border, and I wanted to know what exactly you meant when you said crosses the Kynes border.
Well, we don't have any evidence that's ever happened. Okay. And we have all we have is evidence that if you breed two animals, they produce after their kind, just like the Bible says. And there's no mechanism for this. If you believe that one kind can beget another kind over successive generations, over thousands upon thousands of years, then you need to be able to show. Hold on, please. Let me finish. Then you need to be able to show that it happens, and there needs to be a mechanism.
My question. Your own question.
No, there needs to be asked,
and I'm trying to get to that specifically.
I answered your question.
Different kind. Do you believe evolution states that one kind can beget a different kind? I answered that question.
I said no. But if you believe it, then you need to show us a mechanism for it and the physical evidence. Please allow me to respond. You're going to have to allow me to respond without talking over me.
Okay.
So if you believe that, you need to be able to show a mechanism for it and show examples that it's happened, because that's your belief system, not mine.
Okay. Can you do me a favor and give me shorter answers if you're going to insist I don't interrupt you to keep you on track with the questions that I asked?
I don't think I was carrying on real long myself.
Okay. Anyway, so you had brought up one kind beget a different kind, and we both agree that that's false and that nobody actually, no theories actually say that. So we move on. The other thing that you had talked about was there's no transitional fossils. Are you aware that every single living thing that has ever existed has had its own unique DNA and is, by definition, transitional?
That's a mythological belief that you hold to.
But that's what the evidence shows us.
No, it doesn't show that.
Oh, okay. So how
did let me verify that for you. I'll verify that for you. Let me give you some examples. I'm not going to go through all these, but if you want to go back through this video and watch this full screen and read these are all statements from the most prominent scientists that have existed on this planet in the last 50 years, and every one of them states that the fossil record shows stasis and not clear evidence of transition. You don't have to take my word for it. Take the word of Stephen Jay Gould, Ernst Mayr, Purcell Cloud, and all them. Okay.
Then are you saying that there are times when certain members of the species have cloned themselves?
I'm not sure what you mean by cloning.
You have a different DNA from your parents, right?
No, nobody believes that every creature, the creation model doesn't predict that every creature should be an exact copy of itself. Evolution posits that anatomy, structural design changes. Evolution posits that anatomical change takes place in increments, ultimately resulting in two fundamentally different types of living things. There is no mechanism for it, no evidence in the fossil for it, and no evidence in any living thing on the planet right now.
Okay, but my point is you have different DNA than your parents, right?
Yes, I do.
They had different DNA than their parents.
Yes, they did.
We can go all the way up to Adam and Eve, and we can say that everybody on the planet has had their own unique DNA, right?
Yeah, there are genetic change does take place, but it's your mythological belief that genetic change causes structural design change. It does no such thing.
Okay, but my point is you say there's no transitional fossils, and when we think about transitional fossils, we're actually talking about fossils that are many generations apart that are in between fossils that we already have. My point to you is that every living thing that has ever lived is transitional. My DNA is different and unique from everybody else's on the planet. And it's because of this that the populations change over time. You are aware of that, right?
That's your mythological belief. Now, if you believe that's true, I would ask you, what's the physical evidence that that's occurring? Because if what you said was a mechanism that's going on for all living things, you should be able to show in the anatomies of hundreds, if not thousands upon thousands of species that are living on this earth today, that they're in the process of evolutionary change. There should be anatomical features arising in their body plans, and there should be anatomical features that they currently exist that demonstrate they're being transformed so that they have new biomechanical functions.
Well, there would be evidence
in the fossil record that this has taken place countless times, and there's no evidence in my anatomy or your anatomy that there's one structural design difference between your body and mine.
I don't think you exactly understand evolution fully, because evolution doesn't your son gets kidneys, congratulations,
nobody's saying that
uptick.
You're strawmanning the creation model. Nobody believes that.
You just said we don't see structures forming and all of that. But you're talking about a process that takes hundreds of thousands of generations of life before these changes evolve very, very slowly over time. Over 20 years, you've got a new organ or something.
Nobody believes that. Nobody believes what you're saying.
Well,
creationists don't believe
that. Why did you just
present it
that way?
Let me ask you a question. You do understand, don't you, that nobody believes that a fish popped out a land-dwelling amphibian tetrapod, right? Boom.
Correct.
They gave birth to it, right? So why do you straw man the creation model? Creationists don't believe that. But if you want to believe that, you're welcome to.
But you
do also understand, don't you, that if that kind of change takes place, as you believe as an evolutionist, there would be countless examples of that transition going on in living things between the fish and the land-dwelling amphibian tetrapod, right? There would be thousands upon thousands of tiny changes, maybe millions, that accrued slowly to produce the one begets the other, right? So where are the fossils that show that?
Are you familiar with
I would appreciate if you'd answer my questions.
Where are the fossils that show that they're in museums, man.
Well, can you give me an example?
I could Google you. There's so many fossils.
That's a mythological belief that the fossils show clear evidence of transition. I've just provided you with probably 150 statements from eminent scientists who say otherwise.
Thing is a transitional fossil. They are all transitional.
Then we should see physical structural design change occurring in the body plans of countless species right now. Where is that? There isn't any. Every living thing on this planet has a features that are fully formed and fully functional, not something that's defunct or coming into being and not actualized yet. There is no such thing in the body plan of any living thing. And there isn't any fossils that show that either. I mean, you're welcome to believe that. So where's this evidence that one type of living thing begets another over time?
Why do you keep saying that? One thing begets another.
What you believe as an evolutionist.
No, it's not.
But you believe that it happens over millions of years of time. Where's the evidence that it occurs? That's what we're looking for. You can't provide it.
Jesus Christ.
So maybe you should have had this evidence before you came to the debate.
I was going to ask you about the vestigial hind legs that are present in modern whales from when they were land-dwelling animals. How does did God create them that way?
The vestigial features of what vestigial feature exactly?
Of whales. Whales have a set of bones that, if they had been allowed to fully develop, would have been legs.
No, they don't.
There's no evidence of that. With that statement.
No, there's no evidence of whale transition at all.
Science disagrees with that statement.
No, science doesn't. Scientists who deny that God is a creator disagree. But
okay. And what percentage of scientists deny that God is a creator?
So, specially created. I don't know. That's hard to say. About 46% or more of scientists are theists, but that doesn't mean they're creationists. And appealing to authority, though, like that's not going to. I don't think that's going to get you anywhere. That's not going to be evidence.
There's a difference between appealing to authority and and accepting the scientific consensus that a lot of other people have been able to show and demonstrate.
Well, I don't agree that anybody's shown any such thing. This is the whale transition that you believe. At the bottom, there's a land-dwelling creature with legs. Another one, and another one above that. Rhodocetus was a fraud created by a scientist named Gingrich. It's been wiped out. Then we go to Duradon. Now, Duradon is just like a modern whale in a way. It has these two little tiny bones that you're talking about right here. They're called ischium. Okay? They don't have anything to do with locomotion. They're bases, anchors for the reproductive organs of the animal. In a male whale, for example, the penis splits into two what are called corporal cavernosa.
Why do they look like little legs?
And what happens is one of those attaches to one bone and one to the other. It's a ridiculous idea to believe that bones that were once part of locomotion somehow become part of reproduction. Didn't the whale already have a penis or a vagina? See, it doesn't make sense.
Nature's crazy sometimes. There's
no evidence. This creature has tiny flippers. Whales don't have any flippers, but they have ischium. These are not ischium that are related to reproduction. These are related to locomotion. This is a fin. Whales have no fins. These bones in a whale are actually anchors for the penis or the clitoris.
So, do you have any scientists you can point me to who would agree with your statement that those are not vestigial legs?
I'm sure they've
possibly been repurposed, which is a perfect example of evolution if it's now used for reproduction. Well,
I don't think repurposing them from locomotion to reproduction is logical, and there are plenty of scientists who don't agree.
Well, you were a land animal, and now you're not.
So you say, what's the evidence of that?
We have evidence.
There just isn't any physical evidence of this. Whales simply don't have any of those bones. And the transition that I showed you supposedly goes from a creature that has no bone, no legs, has legs, I mean, to one that has fins. They show you one that has little fins. And then they show you a whale that has no fins. And so the bones in the whale don't have anything to do with locomotion.
How can you seriously make this claim when you can't tell me what this barrier is that prevents a particular species from diverging too far into its own new kind or whatever?
The barrier is the design of the genetic information doesn't allow for that kind of change.
Okay, but why does all of the fossil evidence and all of the genetic evidence and all of the anatomical evidence disagree with you?
There is no evidence in any of those fields to show that. I've asked you, what's the mechanism for evolutionary change?
Anatomical evolution?
I asked you for the evidence that there's a genetic mechanism for evolutionary change. I explained to you the fossil record shows no clear evidence of evolutionary change. That living creatures that live on this planet right now don't show any clear evidence of evolutionary change. But you believe that's true. So where's the evidence?
I believe that I'm being told the truth by a lot of people who are smarter than me and all agree on it.
I believe the evidence. And the evidence doesn't show any of that.
What you described as evidence that you showed the whale transitioning. You showed my evidence for me.
No, I showed you that there is no evidence.
You basically told me that the evidence is open to interpretation and that the general consensus is interpreting it wrong. Is that a fair assessment?
Yes, of course they're interpreting it wrong.
Okay.
We go from a creature that has Ambulocetus, which has rear legs and front legs, all the bones, tibia, wrist, femurs, tibula, wrist bones, digits, to a creature that has none of those. That's not evidence of transition. Where's the bones disappearing slowly? There's no picture you can make of evolution there. You have a creature with legs, you have a creature with no legs. I mean, heck, there are a lot of creatures that have legs and a lot of creatures that have no legs but fins. It's just your belief that one begat the other. That's not evidence that it took place.
Okay,
so if evolution is true, can you explain to me what mechanism there is for this transition of one kind of living thing to another? What science has demonstrated there's a genetic mechanism for that?
Well, one kind of living thing doesn't become another kind of living thing. It becomes a new living thing. Like, you don't get ducks transitioning into crocodiles or something weird like that. But you do get, if you take a population of something and you split them up, and they're allowed to allow natural selection to go against their environment for a lot of generations, then they will evolve in different ways depending on the environmental pressures that happen to them, and then you will end up with two different species. So,
well, I mean, what do you call a species? Now, you know, you're getting into something really tricky. What do you call a species? Now, if you're claiming ring species show evidence of evolutionary change, the answer to that is no, they don't change in their structural design. They might simply be that one population is no longer able to reproduce with the other because of some kind of genetic change or mutation that's prevented it. But that doesn't, there's no structural design change occurring in ring species. So that's what evolution requires.
It boggles my mind that you accept this. You accept that evolution is true on a short scale, but I don't. You just don't. You're not thinking big enough. You're not going back far enough.
No, I don't believe the myth, the story. I don't believe that. So you're telling me your imagination.
We can see the changes, okay? We can see like a bird start at the bottom of a mountain, and then the population works its way around the mountain, and they have different features when they come around the mountain, and they can't breed.
What different features?
That's a perfect example of the ring species you were talking about.
What features? Different features? What features?
I'd have to look it up.
No, they don't have different features.
But
they have exactly the same anatomy. They simply can't breathe.
Colors change.
That's not anatomical.
Changes.
Color, size, shape, pattern. Those are not anatomical. That's morphology.
Yes, but
morphology won't explain evolution. Evolution contends anatomical change, not morphological.
Sorry, no.
But you need to give it more. You need to give it more time.
Well, now you're just telling me to believe your imaginative story, not physical evidence.
But
I don't believe that story.
That's what the scientific consensus has agreed that the physical evidence means. And so far you've come to me and you've claimed that there's this arbitrary barrier, but you don't know what the barrier is or what mechanism prevents the barrier from crossing.
I did.
You told me that life requires a spirit, but you don't have a way to demonstrate a spirit other than to claim that symbolism and other abstract concepts act as evidence that there is something beyond the physical that we just can't demonstrate. You've just come at me with assertions that don't make any sense.
No, I think you're demonstrating your spirit with every word you speak, because you're creating some non-physical fundamental entities. You're employing linguistics, and that can't happen if chemistry explains all we are. Now, you say that ring species show evolutionary change. They'll have different features when the one species and is separated from the other, one population from the other, on the other side of the mountain over enough time. We don't know of any example of ring species that have changed anatomically. They have the same features. They might have morphological differences, like shorter feathers or shorter hair. Shorter hair or longer hair. This kind of thing.
We haven't been observing them for 100,000 years.
Well, that's where your imagination comes in. The actual structural changes will occur, but we don't have the evidence for that. When you said I have this imaginary barrier, I said it's the design of the information is the barrier. It doesn't provide for such change.
And
I asked you, what's the mechanism for that? And you haven't been able to give me one.
Oh, the mechanism for change? You mean like natural selection?
No, from one type of organism into a fundamentally begats over numerous generations a fundamentally different type of organism with a different anatomy.
Well, the changes that happens when you have, like, for example, a ring species that we were talking about, the small changes, those add up over many more generations. Maybe the beak gets shorter, and then the beak gets shorter, and then the beak gets shorter, and then the beak gets shorter, and in 100,000 years, you have a bird with lips. Like,
we have evidence of birds with lips?
Just as an example, just as a random example, that is the mechanism, is that we can observe these changes. We have observed these changes over the short term, and I mean the last, 200 years or so is my definition of the short term. And these changes just add up and 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 add up. And then after many, 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 many more generations than your mind is contemplating, you have something different.
Well, you told me we have evidence for birds with lips. Or,
no, I did not tell you we had evidence.
Okay, so lips. But
my
that kind of change
was the changes keep going in a particular direction because the environment selects and the species that the species members that survive in that particular environment are selected for that. That was my example. My problem here is that you're just not thinking back far enough.
No, I don't accept imagination.
You've accepted everything you have described has been exactly the definition of evolution, except for your time frame and your mechanisms of change.
No, you're telling me about the imaginative story in your imagination. You're not telling me about physical evidence. And ring species don't demonstrate anatomical change. They demonstrate things like a bird's beak can get smaller. They demonstrate that a bird can get a smaller beak, a longer fur of feathers, or shorter feathers. But that's not an anatomical change. That kind of change, what you might call microevolutionary change, does not change anatomy. It changes morphology.
Okay. No such
now,
thing
if you believe,
if you
believe that anatomical change actually does take place, and it's not just something in your imagination, there should be evidence for that, and not in a, there should be a mechanism, there should be evidence in the fossils and evidence in the living things that live on this planet right now. You're just telling me the story in your head.
I'm telling you the story that scientists have told the rest of us, and I'm telling you a story that people who have examined the evidence all agree with.
Well, then where's the evidence? I don't take their opinion about it. I take the evidence. What's the evidence? The evidence shows no such thing.
You went up and showed me earlier the chart that had the picture of the fossils that scientists have found and used in your chart. I mean,
And I explained to you that one is creature with legs, and the other one is a creature with fins.
How do you think they drew that chart?
No, what it shows is
fraudulent, and they made them up. But why do you think that the other ones weren't marked down as fraudulent?
Maybe
because there's a fossil that they were based off of.
What the images, what the fossils show there is that we have a creature with fully formed rear legs, and then we have none. We have a creature with fins. Where's the evidence? Now, if this transition took place, we should see the creature losing all the bones and becoming fins. But we don't have those transitions. They don't exist. So they're just all the evolutionists would do is taking a creature that has legs and putting it next to a creature that has two little fins and saying, can you see in your imagination how one begat the other? But I don't see that. What we need is A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J. Now we
So you want all 100,000 generations in between there. Okay.
B through H don't exist. We don't even have three, much less 10.
Well, I'm going to concede the evidence to the scientific consensus there. You brought up cosmology. I was trying to type everything down. What did you say of the myth of cosmology, that the Earth was millions of years old and that's a myth?
It's a myth that the Earth and the planets in our solar system formed from the debris left over from an exploded star, and that the Earth was once a ball of hot magma that cooled over a period of millions of years. That's a myth.
Okay, so how old do you say that the Earth actually is?
I believe the Earth is 6,200 or so years old.
Okay. What would you say about the city of Damascus and that it's been continuously inhabited for 11,000 years?
I would say that anthropologists, employ assumptions, just like evolutionary scientists do, about the age of one culture or another based on their secular timeline. And so they erroneously date one city as being having existed for 7,000 years. They do the same, make the same mistake with the Egyptians' kings list by including dating on the artifacts they found. They do the same thing with the Egyptian kings list by including sons of pharaohs who co-ruled with their dad and make them a separate pharaoh, adding 50 to 75 years to the Egyptian timeline. You do that 10 times, you've added 750 years to the existence of the Egyptian king empire. See?
Oh, okay, so what about the radiometric dating that was used on artifacts that were found in and around the basin surrounding Damascus?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's you're probably talking about carbon 14, because carbon 14 has an upper limit of 50,000 years.
We use more than we can radiometric date with any element on the periodic table, and we do so often, and we check our results with different ones as long as it's within, you know, the reasonable parameters for dating with that particular element.
Yeah, there's all kinds of assumptions that are involved in radiometric dating processes. And let me give you an example. If somebody started lit a candle and walked into the room, can you tell by how tall the candle is how long it's been burning? And the answer is no, because you don't know. You just walked into the room. You don't know when the candle was lit, so you don't know how long it's been burning. So the thing is,
but if
when it comes to dating,
the candle was, I could give you an estimate.
You don't know that. That's the thing. You don't know. So when it comes to dating methods are based on assumptions. They assume that all the parent isotope was produced in situ, that is where it's found, without any slow gradual process. It just appeared. It had to have rapidly appeared so that the dating method can begin, the process of decay can begin. And they assume that no daughter isotope was present when that process occurred. They assume that no parent isotope was added to that location by the action of water over millions of years or removed from it. They assume that no daughter isotope was added to or removed from that location over millions of years.
Can
lots
I cut
of
you
problems
short and ask you a quick question here?
Please.
Okay. Are you telling me that an entire scientific field of study is just plain wrong?
No, the scientific study is not field is not wrong. The conclusions that are come to by uniformitarianists are wrong. And if what I would suggest you do is watch.
What is a uniformitarianist?
What I would suggest for you is that you watch videos by creationist geologists who discuss the various problems with radiometric dating, so you'll see what problems actually exist with it.
So how come mainstream science doesn't agree with the problems that all of these creationist scientists seem to come up with when it comes to radiometric dating?
Because it's part of their worldview, and they don't want to pull one card out from their house of cards because the whole thing falls then.
So basically what you're saying is there's a conspiracy in science to lie about...
No, not a conspiracy. There's a worldview that they protect dogmatically and refuse to see the evidence for what it is because their worldview takes precedence.
Oh, okay. So so then you believe that an entire scientific field of study is wrong then?
No, the field is not wrong. The conclusions of the of members of the scientific community are erroneous. They falsely interpret the evidence, and they rely on assumptions. See, for example, punctuated equilibrium in the fossil record. It's assumed that countless transitional forms actually existed, but somehow erosion magically washed them all away, and it just left us with the one creature and then the next, and they say, see how it happened? This one begat that one over enough time. We can't show you the transitions in between, but they were there, trust me. That's punctuated equilibrium in a nutshell. That's not scientific, that's a belief.
Okay, so then how come a Nobel Prize hasn't been issued for the truth coming out? Because science is a self-correcting process. When we look at the evidence and we can demonstrate something different than what's normal, science corrects. Science goes, we were wrong. So you're telling me that it not only is an entire scientific field wrong. They're wrong because they're biased because of their worldview, and they're not doing it consciously. And you want me to believe that every single person who has ever done any kind of radiometric dating is just wrong because of their worldview, because they have this need to confirm something.
Absolutely.
We're going to go to... So, sorry, Jerry.
How much of science is correct then? How much of science can we rely on if we can just chuck radiometric dating right out the door?
Science is correct. The conclusions of secular scientists are erroneous because of their paradigm.
Okay, but so if the conclusions are incorrect, you're suggesting we chuck an entire scientific field right out the door?
No, no. What we should see happen is that scientists actually accept the data for what it is and not what's in their imagination. Instead, they swap it. It's a shell game. They swap out the data and they look at the data and say, gee, all these mutations cause destructive effects to the organisms. But then they turn around and say, mutations design structural design and do fantastic things to make one new type of living thing come into being. But then they go back to the science papers and they write, but we observed this mutation caused this destructive effect. Then they turn around out of the other side of their mouth and say, mutations do marvelous and ingenious things. That's what I'm talking about.
Just so we can go to Q&A, I want to let... Sorry, Jared, one sec.
It's finally getting good. Just kidding. Why is it only a fringe group of creationist scientists claim that the conclusions of an entire scientific field are wrong, and all of the people that are in that scientific field who like to verify each other's results for Nobel Prizes and the like have not been able to refute each other?
Well, creationists have completely refuted evolution. One evolutionist is not going to debunk the evidence provided by another if they believe the same thing. You know, if they rely on their assumptions the same way as the other guy, that doesn't make sense why they would do that. But, you know, a number of evolutionist scientists have actually argued with other evolutionist scientists about what the data shows. Some scientists have said, if you claim that there are clear evidence of transition in the fossil record, you know, you've got to be crazy. That would be an unscientific thing to do.
I'm going to go ahead and conclude here and let James get to the Q&A he's dying to get to. I'm just going to say, science is wrong, everybody.
That's not what my point is. That's not my position.
That's your position with regards to the entire conclusions of the entire field of radiometric dating.
Science is correct. Science is a process. It's correct.
But the conclusions of an entire the conclusions of an entire scientific field is wrong. So.
No, it's not the entire scientific field. By the way, creationist scientists publish also, and they disagree with the secular camp about
radiometric dating. But they're such a small minority that nobody takes them seriously.
No secular takes them seriously.
Which is most of them.
Irrelevant. That doesn't provide data.
All right. Let's do questions.
We can go to Q&A. And what we'd like to do, though, is if you'd like to have like any wrap-up time, Jared, we can give you that. Especially because we had Neff start. And so if you want to kind of do like a closing statement or something, like rough equivalent, you're welcome to do that just because we... had that start.
All right. I'll just say a quick few things. First, we've basically had a description given to us of variation between kinds, which in my opinion is exactly the same thing as evolution with an arbitrary barrier on how far the life can change. My opponent here has not been able to tell us what mechanisms this arbitrary barrier operates on. My opponent has made claims that science cannot verify, like that there's extra things involved with life, like spirits and whatnot. We have all kinds of evidence for evolution we've been piling on for, you know, over 200 years. And there's the only thing that we have that's been presented has has been claims that disagree with mainstream science. We have the claim that the Earth is 6,000 years old, and we have things that we know are older than 6,000 years. And we have we have the claims that the conclusions of several fields of science, or at the very least, radiometric dating is wrong, and that the conclusions of evolutionists who study evolution for a living are wrong. So I guess the conclusions of science is wrong, and therefore young Earth creationism. And that's where I'll leave it.
Gotcha. Next, we will go into the Q&A, which we have great questions. So first, I want to say thanks to the debaters for their speeches. And also, though I think they're assertive, they are still in control, which I appreciate very much. It makes it, frankly, easier on me. And the other thing is, I think it makes it more enjoyable for the audience and me just to listen. So with that, very excited about these. First, let's see. Lazarus asks, question for Neff. How does Neff account for countless Christians who believe in evolution, and even the Pope who endorses the theory of evolution?
Well, people are easily beguiled sometimes, and people can come to believe a thing, especially if they haven't examined the data themselves, and they'll fall prey to believing the consensus of the scientific community, which is largely atheist, and therefore married to a uniformitarianism and evolutionism. And but since they wear lab coats and they do science all the time, they have unfettered faith that what they'll tell them is true, because they lack the scientific knowledge and have not investigated the data itself. If they would throw out their faith in what the secular camp is telling them and examine the scientific evidence, as myself and many other creationists have done, they would see a whole different picture.
Gotcha. Next, thank you very much for that answer, Neff, and also thank you so much for that question, Lazarus. Next, forgive me if I'm pronouncing it wrong. Is it Guzman or Guzman? I think it's Guzman. It's Guzman 1611 says, question for Patient Beard. We have pain sensory nerves all over our body. Why would nature create sensory nerves? Because it doesn't care if we have pain. Why would we have them?
Well, nature doesn't really care. Nature just does what nature does according to the laws of nature. We have sensory and our ability to feel because a long time ago in the evolutionary tree, we had the development of the nervous system developing in very basic life, and life that was able to react to what it felt and move about its environment is the reason why the nervous system was able to proliferate into, you know, almost all living things. There's very, very few living things that don't actually have a nervous system that aren't plants. You know, over time, you know, if you have two species members and one of them is numb or can't feel very well, and one of them can really feel good, the one might not survive. It might wander into the sun or whatever. And then so you get this you know, with each successive generation, you have what survives better, does better. And basically, through our evolutionary history, being able to feel pain has been better for those species members than not being able to feel pain. So those ones did better, and that's why we can touch and feel pain.
Gotcha. Thank you very much. And next up, Lazarus says, question for Neff, can someone be a true Jew or Christian and not believe in the creation story in Genesis?
I believe it's possible to do. Yes, I believe so. I believe that their beliefs are simply not in line with what the scriptures say or with reality. They've allowed themselves to fall prey to pseudoscience ideas in the imagination of the secular camp.
You bet. Next, we have Riley S. asks, she says, you should ask Neff what exactly he means by quote-unquote structural design change, if losing the ability to interbreed doesn't count.
Okay, structural evolution posits the arrival of features, not the loss of a feature. You can never have a tree of life, an evolutionary a tree of life, unless structural design, that is anatomy, what types of features exist in the body plan of an organism. Unless those features are produced over time, there'll be no such thing as a tree of life. And no reason to believe that all living things are related to each other. Structural design simply is a term I'm using to describe anatomical development of features. The anatomical features come into being over time by incremental change, resulting in a structural design that exists in the animal, like a feather from a non-feather. That's a structural design change difference, right? A creature which has no feather and a creature which has feathers, that's a structural design difference. That's anatomical change. That's what evolution posits takes place constantly, and there's just no evidence for that.
Except that they're both related to a common ancestor that created keratin from follicles.
Except that that argument fails if you examine the evidence.
We can go to the next question, and let's see. Thanks so much for that last one, by the way. Jeremy Pace asks, why are some biologists Christian who accept evolution?
Could you repeat the question? Why do some Christians accept and believe in evolution?
Yeah, basically said, why are some biologists Christian who accept evolution?
Okay, because they're, that's a very difficult question. It may be the case for some that there's something about creation being true that doesn't sit well with them. They don't like the personability of what the creation model explains. It might be a theological problem they have that causes them to not accept it. And in some cases, I think it's true, in many, many cases, scientists men of science who are Christians do not believe evolution theory, but cannot say so, that they doubt it or disbelieve it outright, because they know that if they do, they will lose their lucrative jobs. And the evidence for that is profound. I would suggest anybody looks into a book written by, or lectures written, given by Jeffrey Tompkins, not Jeffrey Tompkins, I can't remember his name anyway. The title of it is Slaughter of the Dissidents, where numerous examples of scientists who doubted evolution theory were kicked out of their profession by the secular camp simply because they doubted evolution theory or did not believe it.
Gotcha.
My answer is going to be cognitive dissonance.
Totally. The question wasn't for you, was it?
Totally. Well, let's see. We can go to the next one. I suppose for future questions. By the way, thanks so much for your super chat. And I want to pronounce this right. Forgive me if I get it wrong. Elowatchus. So thank you so much for your super chat. Totally means a lot. And if you had a question, I saw it without an actual question or comment attached. If you had one that you meant to, because I know I've done it before where I was like, I forgot to put the comment or question on. Just let me know and I will still add it to the super chat list. So, but otherwise, if it's just a super chat to support the channel, thanks so much. Totally appreciate it. And So questions, would you guys like to be able to respond? I'm open, I'll really defer to you. So in other words, like if Jared gets asked a question and Neff wants to give his response to what Jared just said, like do you guys want to allow that? We did forget to ask that before the debate.
I'm okay with that.
Okay.
That's all right with me.
You got it. So let's see. The Raging Atheist asks for Patient Beard. did God create the science that disproves him, or did he create the conspiracy theories that disproves the science that God must have created?
Is that for me?
Actually, it's said for patients.
I think the question is specious, and it's a straw man with a question mark behind it. I'm not going to answer. No point in it.
This is an interesting question. Jared, if you want to ask it, it actually did say for patient beard. So.
Oh, repeat the question one more time.
Yeah, so it says, did God create the science that disproves him, or did he create the conspiracy theories that disprove the science that God must have created?
I would say God has to exist to create anything.
Gotcha. You bet. Thank you very much. And thanks very much, the Raging Atheist. You guys remember him. He's got energy. We like that. So he will be back on, and it'll be a good convo coming up this week. So let's see. Jeremy Pace asks why. Oh, we asked that already. Sorry about that. That's embarrassing. Here we go. Eagle Nutrients asks question for Neff: why is your culture's creation myth true, and none of the others are?
Well, that's another straw man. I don't have a creation myth. I have a creation fact, and science verifies it. Why are there different myths? Why do myths about creation exist? I believe it's because people fell. The reason the Bible has the accurate record of creation is because it was inspired by God. And after the Tower of Babel affair, man fell away from knowing and believing in the one true God, and no longer had made a record from the Holy Spirit of anything. So they come up with false ideas, crazy ideas.
You bet.
Like evolution, which was a religious idea propagated first, cosmological evolution, first propagated, as far as we know, by the Hindu Brahmins, followers of the belief in the false god Brahma, who created a cosmic egg that exploded, and that's the origin of the Big Bang Theory. It goes back thousands of years.
That's not too different from, you know, talking snakes and magic gardens.
God can make a snake talk if he wants. Snakes don't talk, but God can make whatever he wants to happen. If God can design DNA in a cell, which is more complex than New York City, he could certainly make a snake.
But the cosmic egg, that's too much. We crossed the line with the cosmic egg.
That's all you say.
Next up, we have a question coming in. By the way, thanks for that last question. And we have a question coming in from Mark Caesar. Did Nephi accept carbon dating to be accurate to about 50,000 years and then say he believes the Earth is about 6,000 years old?
Carbon dating has its own problems. It can be, in general, a pretty accurate process for a few thousand years. I believe the upper limits of it, 30, 40,000 years, can't be supported. And the reason for that is that carbon-14 is created and destroyed at the same time in the upper atmosphere of the Earth by the sun. It creates it, and it also destroys it. Now, over time, that would cause what's called carbon-14 equilibrium. That is, the amount being destroyed by the sun should equal the amount that's being created by it. And that would create a stasis. It would be a constant level, and it would not increase, and it would not decrease. That process, according to the calculations of many creationist scientists, would take no more than 30,000 years. So this is evidence that the Earth cannot be even 30,000 years old.
So carbon dating is accurate until you want to measure something in the Bible with it. Got it.
The more time you add to a dating process, the more you have to employ assumptions.
Next, we have, thanks for that question, by the way, and Lucifer Almighty asks, why can't creationists go to the scientific community and demonstrate their position?
They do demonstrate it all the time. They're not allowed to publish their results in the secular journals because of peer review. They're prevented. We're all familiar with Michael Behe, a paper being published that was in support of intelligent design, and the journal editor who allowed it to be published getting canned for it. So they just don't allow. So creationists have created their own journals, and they publish in their own journals, since the secular camp says they won't allow creationists to publish.
It's because the secular camp doesn't even accept.
But creationist scientists do publish in the secular journals, as in the last 10 years, a handful or two of papers that are that support the idea of intelligent design have actually been published in secular science journals. So the tide is just beginning to sway, and the door is cracked open, and in the coming years, it will be wide open.
Some more science is right, unless we're trying to verify the Bible. Gotcha.
Well, that's your straw man against it. I mean, you know, and yet you couldn't provide a shred of scientific evidence for your storyboards tonight.
So, forgive me. I promise, Jared, the next question, I'll let you have the last response, but I just have to keep moving just so we can try to get through these last several. So, this one's from Lucifer Almighty, and he asks, forgive me, my memory's so bad today that... Did I ask why can't creationists go to the scientific community and demonstrate their position? Question. Yeah.
That's the one we just answered.
Okay, that's embarrassing. Okay, thanks for your patience. Here we go. Abed Eulogy asks for Neff, what impact has Neff had on the scientific consensus, and what research paper has Neff published?
Ask the question again, please.
Yeah, so it's for Neff, what impact have you had on the scientific consensus, and what research paper have you published?
It's illogical to believe that I personally would have should be expected to have had an impact on the scientific community. So I think that's just a way of somebody asking a question designed to try to ridicule it. It's pretty much an invalid question. They might as well, you know, go vomit in the corner.
Gotcha. Thanks for your honesty. So we appreciate your question, and we appreciate all the other questions. These were terrific questions, and very glad to have everybody involved. A lot of new faces tonight or today, or some of you, it might even be morning. I think I saw somebody from Australia. So with that, I want to say thanks to the debaters. The debaters have gotten in the hot seat. They've given their time to us, so we want to say thanks so much. Their links, as mentioned, are in the description. So if you want to check them out, even if you're just like, you know what, I've seen that Nephilim and Nephilim, can't take it. He'll grow on you. You just have to check his channel out. Same thing with Jared. If you're pulling your hair out saying, ah, Jared, why is your beard constantly flooding the camera? Well, you know what? You get to see even more of that on his channel. Mm-hmm. Sounds pretty good, right? Well,
hey, and I didn't eat a meal.
Yes, that's true.
I was told not to.
Straight, that's true. Only because I made him not do it. So, people pointed out last time. I just said, hey, if you're all right with it, you don't need to. A lot of people, yeah, they just don't want to. Is it Jared? Everybody in the live chat, I'm curious. Is it you don't want to watch Jared eat, or is it just anybody? Don't worry, Jared. I'm sure it's just anybody. Okay, so. Want to mention, as we did before, we've got some exciting events coming up. We do have next week, this is not a joke, we'd love to get the opinions of the debaters as well. We do have a debate called Is Christianity a Hate Group? And if you guys want to weigh in on that, Jared, if you happen to have the mute button, we can hear you typing.
Okay,
it's no problem. But what are your guys' thoughts? This is provocative. Last time we, a lot of feathers were ruffled because we hosted Is Atheism a Hate Group? And we gave, you know, everybody had their side represented. So same thing will be true for Is Christianity a Hate Group? Is this a bad idea? Should we just get away from the whole, like, is X a hate group? That's become somewhat common now. Thoughts, Neff and Jared?
I apologize. What was the question one more time?
That's all right. basically, is this wise to have such a topic, or maybe we're veering off what we should be sticking with, given how offensive it might be?
Is it wise to have what topic?
Is Christianity a hate group?
I would say that there are sects of Christianity that qualify as hate groups. Westboro Baptist Church comes to mind. They're a pretty famous, hateful bunch of people. I think that Christians don't truly follow their Bible. Most Christians don't truly follow their Bible. They don't follow the hateful parts. They like to cherry pick the good parts. So I think most Christians and most Christian sects tend to be peaceful and nonviolent. And some are discriminatory, and some are hateful. I would say in general, most are not.
I would say it's possible to find Christians, people who call themselves Christian, who are hateful, in the same way that we can find that vehement atheists can be hateful.
Of course, if
they're a Christian, they're not acting in accordance to their religious beliefs. Now, when it comes to the Bible, the Bible, there's no hateful parts of the Bible. This is a secular camp's straw man argument against the Bible. God doesn't express hatred unjustifiably in the Bible. He hates sin. He hates abuse. He hates murder. He hates people raping. He hates wrong things, and he's right to be just against it. But because he does that, then the atheist will straw man God and say, look, God hates. Of course God hates. God hates it if somebody takes a child into the woods and kills them. You do too.
Why does God hate witches?
Because a witch is a person. God would hate a witch.
We have to go back to the queue, the wrapping up.
We could go down a rabbit hole at that one.
Well,
we could have a whole...
It's easily explained.
You got your chance.
Then I'm going to ask you about why God hates gay people.
Why God doesn't hate gay people.
Okay.
Gotcha. So we will, with that, these guys just can't help but want to start debating again. We appreciate their spirit. So with that, I want to say thanks, everybody. This has been a blast. Love your questions. It's been a great time getting to hang out with you. And hopefully we'll get to have these gentlemen on again. It's always fun to get to have them. And any last wrap-up points? I can say that, like I said, I'm excited that just one debate that we're planning on having. There's another mega event relevant to tonight's subject. That's going to be a lot of fun, too. So I don't want to... I'm like keeping it a secret until maybe a week before. So anyway, thanks for being here, and we hope you have a great night. Keep sifting out the reasonable from the unreasonable.